third important component, the last important component of web-based services model is called SOAP. SOAP is a protocol. You would be familiar with many IP protocols, TCP/IP and such things. TCP/IP, UDP are fundamental protocols just to describe how bits move from this place to another place. But there are, on top of it, there are additional protocols which are application specific. SOAP is a generic protocol which is an XML-based specification for exchange of information in decentralized and distributed environment generically. So SOAP defines a message envelope, it has some encoding rules, and it has a remote procedure call kind of convention defined. That means how to call a remote COBOL program, that remote procedure call convention is described as a part of the SOAP. So basically when a message goes there, if you just let that message act in an interpreted way, it will automatically invoke your COBOL service, do whatever it is, and it will form back the reply. So it's a very, very powerful mechanism of doing this kind of integration. It has a message structure which has an envelope with a header and a body, and it has MIME attachments, just standard attachments with any email that you have. The message exchange model has initial sender and ultimate receiver, any intermediary. I might actually do this SOAP utilization through multiple intermediaries. So my application, my message has to go to an application in Chennai, but it go through another application of a bank which is in Delhi and whatever. So I can actually, because I might want that intermediary to do something with that message, add value to it or whatever, and then send it forward. So that is how the SOAP is defined. I'm sorry. Let's go back very quickly to these three names. I just want to confirm that we understand these three names. UDDI is one standard. This is primarily about the registry, that is subscribing and discovering services. WSDL is about web services description language. You use this description language to describe your services. You create your services using this, you describe them, you register them. You also can discover other services and you can invoke these services. All of this is permitted through WSDL. So programming in WSDL effectively becomes an essential part for anybody who wants to integrate application. And last but not the least is the basic protocol, SOAP. SOAP is not necessarily the most efficient protocol. In specific situations, you may use some other protocols as well. Let me give you an example. I said multiple applications can be integrated in this model, and I said that these applications could belong to different people. Now, just as the same way I mentioned that SWIFT can be used even for transaction between local entities, why can't I use this model for integrating different applications that I have within my own organization? That way, if I'm moving a particular application to a new platform such as a database technology, okay, I can take my own time to decide which application I move to another platform when. As long as existing applications I connect to each other using this protocol. So consider this, you have two servers physically sitting side by side. One is running application A, another is running application B. Both are on local area network. There is no reason why both these applications cannot integrate with each other using exactly the same model. So you have a UDDI registry somewhere in the same place or some other place. Now you will have described in WSDL the services on either side, but to connect them, if you use SOAP, which can be done, two machines talking on just LAN also can use IP protocols and can use SOAP, but SOAP will be very costly. Imagine further that these two applications are not even on two different physical servers, they are running on the same server. The communication is possible through backbone, motherboard itself. In two servers, in case of a local area network, it is possible through a gigabit network. Only for a wide area network, it will be slow. So when you have a LAN or when you have a facility for using only the internal infrastructure of a machine, why would you like to use a costly protocol like SOAP? In that case, what you can do is specifically say, instead of using SOAP, I'll use this faster protocol here. I'll use plain simple TCP/IP, or I'll modify TCP/IP slightly. But these are all issues related to making things perform better. Conceptually, there is no reason why I cannot use a single logical architecture for any application that I write. Going forward, the purpose of all the discussion today is going forward, that logical architecture is a web-based applicational architecture. And all the three standards that I talked about are part of what is called service-oriented architecture. A service-oriented architecture means any programming service that is performed by my application is now capable of being registered, capable of being discovered, capable of being invoked using these standards. So service-oriented architecture is nothing fancy. Service-oriented architecture is an architecture which essentially permits integration of applications, but we don't talk of integration of applications now. We talk of developing applications which are compliant with this SOA architecture. So any new application developed should preferably be designed in this fashion, and if there are any performance related issues, they should be sorted out by localizing those performance problems and solving them there. But making architecture generic, even though might have initial performance issues, you can simply throw hardware and solve those performance issues. But in terms of flexibility, it will be enormous. Going forward in future, half the maramari today that you are facing of integrating multiple different applications will just not exist. So now we will very quickly discuss, since I mentioned the performance issues, how do you measure performance in the context of these applications, and particularly in the context of databases? What is the notion of a performance? How is it measured? How it can be tuned? Whether the performance can be increased by adding hardware, whether the performance requires modification in my software, these are some of the things that we need to answer. So here is some basics of performance. First of all, what is performance? So let's say here is the end user sitting on the machine. You can see he's, many of our users face the same situation. They're not in a much happier place. What he sees is called the response time. He has given a query or he has asked for a report and he is waiting for that report or he is waiting for that query to be answered. Or he has completed a transaction, pressed his return key, is waiting for the next screen to appear. Typically, the difference between these two is called the response time. When he sends a query to a backend system, there are n number of other users who are also sending queries. Say there are 1,000 users who are sending queries. Quite independent of what each individual sees as a response time, for the totality of the system, the important thing is how many of these queries are answered per day, per hour, per second, how many transactions are executed per second. That is called throughput. By and large, throughput and response time are two very fundamental measurements in any performance. So throughput could be in terms of orders per day, orders per minute, requests per second, whatever one. These are the measurable and understandable parameters from an end user point of view. If the end user is an ordinary clerk or officer or application, then for him or her it is response time. If the end user is the manager of the data center, then throughput is the important. Take railway reservation system. So what is the wait time for a customer or what is the time a clerk takes is the response time. How many total reservations per day are handled is what is important to the chief general manager of that region. So he is not particularly concerned whether the customer stands for 1 minute or stands for 2 minutes. He knows that the customer was standing for 2 hours anyway. But for him, 10,000 things handled in a day or 20,000 things handled in a day is important. Overall then, both these are important. Response time is important and throughput is important. In the context of performance, some additional terms that we talk about, particularly for computer system performance. One is called the capacity. The capacity is measured in terms of peak throughput. The capacity is measured in terms of concurrent users. So this particular system, hardware, software, application, everything, together can permit how many concurrent users to operate. A system which permits 2,000 users, if you put 10,000 users on that system will crash. if you want to go from 2,000 to 10,000 users, what additional components you may want to add is a different story. Sometimes you just add hardware, but which hardware to add, not known. Sometimes any amount of hardware you add, it may not make any difference. We should understand why, or if at all it is so. So capacity is an associated term where we talk about peak throughput. For example, we take banking transactions. We say so many transactions per second, say 200 transactions per second is my requirement. I calculated that by calculating that total number of transactions executed in a day are so many. However, if I forget to tell that person who is developing this system for me, not just application software, but hardware, everything, that look, this may be 200 transactions per second is the average thing. However, between 10 o'clock and 12 o'clock, I execute 70% of my day's transaction. Now that's a different information altogether. So that is called the peak throughput requirement. So these are important parameters that I must know. At the individual level, we talk of resource consumption. What are our resources in terms of hardware, CPU, in terms of I/O, it is disk, in terms of memory, it is memory utilization. So these are resources, disk, I/O, memory, they are resources. Bandwidth is another resource. On all these resources, what is the rate of consumption for a system? This consumption rate might have to be specified both as an average and as a peak, as in case of capacity. So this is the description of all basic parameters. Is that understood? Response time, throughput, capacity, and resource consumption. Okay. Now we go to some theory, simple but elegant theory. In terms of understanding how the system performs, we actually look at what we call a work conserving system, okay, and we do some operational analysis. The blue line here indicates arrival of jobs. So a job arrives here. This job is done after some time. This time is called the service time. It takes for this job to be completed. When the job is completed, it goes out. Another job arrives, it goes. Third job arrives, it goes, etc. Sometimes the jobs get completed slowly, sometimes the job comes faster. There could be a time when the job which has come has just about gone and new job has not come. Can there be a time when the red line goes above blue line? That is the nature of the work conserving system. There cannot be a departure before arrival. Somebody should have arrived before somebody departs. So which means this is likely to be the nature of the graph. The symbolism we use is A of t is the total number of arrivals up to time t. D of t is total number of departures up to time t. The difference between A of t and D of t is the number of people in the system at any point in time. These number of people could be number of SQL queries in the system. Anything. System is a system which is providing service. So clients waiting for service is this number, NT. Okay. Now, if you take any point, say take this point, what is N here? 0. Okay. Take this point, what is N here? 2, because there are 2 people waiting. At any point in time, AT minus DT is the number in the system at time T. Is that okay? This number is very easy to understand. So difference between them. We do a complicated analysis now. What is the average number in the system? Go back to the previous slide. Here there were 2, here there was 1, here there was 0, here again is 1, etc., etc. What is the average number of waiting in time? I am using the term number in system. Whether that number is SQL queries or users, whatever, it doesn't matter. So this is the sort of activity which is waiting to be serviced. What is that total activity? What is the average activity? How do I calculate the average? I can actually calculate average by using a simple formula. This is the area which represents users in the system, right? Here it is a 0 user, but here there is 1 user, here there is 1 user, here there are 2 users. So if I take the complete area under this curve, this area represents the total users across the total time. Divide by t, I will get the average user. Those of you who will remember mathematics will recall that an integral of the curve gives you the area under the curve. So if I do an integration, this is a complex formula. If you are not mathematically inclined, you can forget it. If you recall the calculus, you will remember that this number n, okay, which is given by 1 by t, or an integral 0 to 2 nt dt, will give me the average number in the system. The average number can also be calculated, this integral can also be calculated by doing a summation. So I sum, you know, 1 into ri. What is ri? This is the response time. This was the arrival, that is for a request. And this request was sorted out this time. So the response time was this. This was the response time was second. Response time was third, fourth, fifth, etc. So ordinarily there is a response time which is nothing but di minus ai. The departure time minus arrival. So if I do a sigma of this ri, okay, over this 1 to dt, dt is nothing but the total number of departures up to a particular time, I will get the same thing as an integral. There is some jugglery of mathematical symbolism which is done here, basically first showing that this integral is same as 1 upon t sigma of this. Integral is nothing but summation. And then multiplying and dividing by this d of t, which is the total number of departures up to the time t. What is the advantage? Once I do this, d of t upon t has a special significance, and this sigma upon d of t has another special significance. This d of t upon t is, and this is nothing but x and r respectively. That is throughput and response time. This is the average response time, and this is the throughput. And multiplication of this is equal to n. What if the differences are not positive always? Let me explain again. We did say that departure cannot be before arrival. But departure of service request 2 can happen before the departure of service request 1. The service request 1 has come earlier. That query may be just hanging. Somebody else puts a query and that comes up. And then, therefore, if I just list the arrivals and departures in a simple array like this, A1, A2, A3, A4, D1, D2, D3, D4, then this D1 need not always be smaller than D2. D2 may be smaller than D1 because A2 request gets sorted out first one. So the difference could have a problem. However, because I am talking about all arrivals and departures, I can logically conclude that the differences in sigma will be same by simply rearranging these. So I can say if A1 comes at D2, I will mark that D2 as D2 dash and call this D1. So D1 is D2 dash, D2 is D1 dash, D3 is D4 dash, etc., etc. Consequently, response time for any job I is di dash minus ai. I will just take D2 dash minus A2, D4 dash minus D4, D3 dash minus D3, etc. Ultimately, I am saying that in a work conserving system, the sigma will remain the same. Therefore, the shaded area, which is sigma of di minus aj, same as sigma di minus sigma ai, which is same as sigma di dash minus sigma ai, and which is same as sigma di dash minus ai, which is nothing but sigma of the response time. So if I sum up all the response times together, then that sigma is the shaded area. Get the point? So sigma of the shaded area is response time, total. Now we come to the Little's law. If r is the average response time and n is the average number of requests in the system at any time and x is the throughput, that is requests per second, let's say, then Little's law states that n is equal to x into r. This is a very fundamental law on modeling performance. It is very unfortunate that in no programming course this fundamental law is even mentioned. As a result, programmers who are often responsible for maintaining the performance of the system and often responsible for determining what should be the server configuration, what should be the user configuration, etc., are denied the availability of a very simple thumb rule. So we'll look at that thumb rule in a moment, but let's absorb the Little's law. In words, it states that the average numbers in the system is equal to system throughput multiplied by average response time. Please note that originally we thought response time and throughput were two independent entities. They are independent, but they are related to each other in the following sense. Average number in the system at any time is equal to system throughput multiplied by average response time. Let's understand the significance of individual components of this Little's law. For example, N, we said, is the average number of requests in the system. This could be interpreted in real life as number of concurrent HTTP sessions, number of concurrent SQLs. So there are 1,000 users who are sending SQLs, but there are only 300 SQLs which are being sent concurrently. Then 300 SQLs are in the system at any time. It is in the context of these 300 that I want to speak of response time and throughput. The average number in the queue, average number of people in cafeteria, average number of people in airport, average number of projects in hand. Little's law is not only for computer science, but Little's law is a general law for operations. Wherever response time, throughput and the number in system are related, like, look at the interpretation of throughput. Request per second is the nomenclature that we have used. It could mean the number of HTTP hits per second. It could mean disk IOs per second. It could mean database requests per second. It may mean validations per second. It may mean departure rate from cafeteria per hour or in a per airport or number of projects completed per year, anything throughput related. Notice that DB request per second need not automatically translate to business transaction. One business transaction may do two database updates, one database insert, one three database reads. So total request may be 7. But that mapping can be done by looking at the query. So once I know what are these numbers, I can roughly map them into my business numbers. You get the point? So ultimately we say the Little's law simply states that whatever be my response time and whatever be average response time and whatever be my throughput, their product will represent the average number of requests within the system. And average number of requests within the system is invariably a end user requirement. He will say, I have 1,000 concurrent users. Or he will say, I will have so many people, not more than so many people waiting in the queue, etc. In that context, let us look at some very simple, non-trivial, almost trivial-like but non-trivial application of the law. Okay. There is one more thing. These things, imagine that a service request comes from the user, immediately it is answered and the user goes. Invariably in real life, in programming particularly, it is not that the requests are coming from the same user. Suppose I complete my HTTP transaction, it's not that I will again ask for it. Or if I send a query, it's not that instantaneously I will send another query. For example, if I am updating a premium payment by a customer, then I will have a screen. When that fellow comes, I will enter the data for that screen. And when I enter, the data will go in. Next time when another customer comes, okay, meanwhile I will collect his money, I will measure that money, something, count that money, something I will do. This time is called think time. That means even if I have n users in the system, each user is not doing fadafat transactions only. There is a think time followed by a transaction. That is, in real life, that is what happened in case of computer systems. And that is modeled by, you can still apply Little's law to business transactions. So here is a system R, which is our system. There are n users here. Now each user is sending a request and getting a response. That response time was R. But now we say, I add some think time Z to that response. Because that user, although he's a concurrent user, is unlikely to send another request before this think time. So the placement of service will now, placement of request will now happen not at every R instance, but R plus Z instance. So if R is the response time, then response time plus think time is together equivalent of a virtual response time for that. And therefore, N is now stated to be equal to X into R plus Z rather than only R. All that we have done is, we have modified this think time to make it realistic. Otherwise, 300 concurrent users could actually flabbergast your server to 100% usage. There is no wait time for that server at all. Requests are just coming like that. That never happens in real life. Whatever be the number of concurrent users.
So what actually we derive from this is that the system capacity planning which we are doing is definitely going to be significantly higher than just only looking at the throughput and response time.
In fact, it's the other way around. If you do not take Z into account, then the capacity will become very higher. But if you take Z into account, then you don't require that much capacity. Because if you say X into R plus Z, if you don't have Z, N will be smaller.
Yes.
For the same system.
So number of users in the system
will become but if you add Z, the number of users that the system can support will become larger.
Okay.
So given a system, if you don't take think time at all, let's say that system according to you permits 20 concurrent users. But if you add think time of 3 seconds to everyone,
the number of
users will increase. So the same system can support more users in practice. Although N into X into R will give you a slightly different picture. Calculating this Z realistically, therefore, is very important. If you calculate this wrongly, there could be huge problem. There is a very nice example in the total slide deck which will go on open source, where he was asked, they were asked, you know, there was an RFP actually. This is a real life story, the RFP. And they said there are so many concurrent users and the total number of the transaction rate, that is the throughput we want, is this much. And they found that that throughput was impossible to do. Let me first give you the next example and then in conclusion, I will tell you that particular thing. So this is the example here. Okay, first some simple additional analysis. We'll come back to this issue of this bottleneck analysis. If you have a pipeline, then you need to understand that in serial mode and in pipeline mode, the computations are different. So here is an example. If a car is made by first making a chassis in 2 minutes, door in 4 minutes, then a window in 2 minutes, and paint it in 2 minutes, hypothetically. The first car that comes out takes 8 minutes. But if you have a pipeline, you keep pushing the things from here and there, at what frequency you will get these cars out? You will not get it every 2 minutes. Although the paint is capable of finishing a car in 2 minutes, but there is a bottleneck here. Door is a bottleneck. That door requires 4 minutes. So this fellow, the window painter, window maker will make it in 2 minutes and wait for 2 minutes. The pipeline is choked here. So the choke point determines the total throughput. A pipeline mode, ordinarily I should have get 4 cars per 8 minutes. Okay, but now I will get only 1 car per 4 minutes or 2 cars per 8 minutes because of this choke point.
Actually, what I appreciate from here is probably the door is, translating this example into our real world. Probably not real world, IT world. So this door probably may be the network bandwidth.
Could be
the network bandwidth.
Yes, yes, yes.
So actually, how this network bandwidth should be estimated, take into consideration the concurrency, response time.
Yes.
Then is there any research or something available on the from the network perspective?
There should be, but what you need to construct is an end-to-end scenario for an end user. An end user sitting in Jharsuguda working on the network of 64 kbps and there are 20 users there. You know the average bandwidth required, what is the bandwidth available. It is not alone the bandwidth, but the delays are important in this case. Let me give you an example. This happened in Unit Trust of India when they were using satellite communication. Satellite communication has a certain bandwidth, but has enormous delay because the signals have to go 30,000 kilometers up and come back. Now, they had this application where the end user logs in onto the Unix server here and does a transaction. Unfortunately, the application which they had done, even for login, was actually using plain Unix services. In Unix, from a terminal, if you log in, every character that you type actually goes to the Unix server, comes back and then gets shown on your screen. Every character has to go and come back. When you do it at a terminal connected on RS-232 or LAN interface, no problem. You do it through satellite, he will type a character, sit like this. Type a character, sit like this. Login would take 2 minutes. Okay. Every transaction interface where he was typing the data would take that kind of. People stopped using that system. So there you have to rewrite the application. So how do you solve this bottleneck? The bottleneck in the bandwidth. You say, I have good bandwidth, but I have this delay. To reduce the delay, I will not transport one character at a time. I will take a bunch of 1,000 characters and push all of them together. Now, this is the way you will solve bandwidth related problem. But you are very right that bandwidth could become a bottleneck where everything else is fast. And no matter how fast you make all other systems, the choke will always be here. In fact, identifying the choke in an end-to-end system is a very fundamental requirement of a good diagnosis of performance. Very, very correct. Very, very good point that you made. Here is another example of a similar type. There are 20 seconds, 20 seconds, 20 seconds. So in a serial mode, one order per 60 seconds. But in a pipeline mode, you can get 3 orders per 60 seconds. However, if the burger takes 30 seconds instead of 20 seconds, then that will become a choke point. So identifying a choke point is an important thing. Okay. This is about whenever you have a pipeline. And invariably, you will have a pipeline, particularly in a distributed transaction. Take a simple example. Somebody in the branch, okay, wishes to do a transaction from a customer after identifying the authentic signature of the customer. The person logs in. He has a part which is a local application. He has a document retrieval system which takes him somewhere else. And let's say he has a requirement to confirm from the bank something, something. So he has one application which is local, which hits local thing, another which requires, let's say, a zone level kind of server, and a third one which is on internet somewhere. If the choke point is internet, no matter how fast you make the other thing, it will remain like. So the identification of choke points in pipeline is important. Let's go back 2 slides and come back to our conclusion about the Little's law. Very important point. N is the average number of requests in the subsystem, which could be concurrent HTTP sessions, number of concurrent SQLs, whatever, whatever, whatever. And this N is related by Little's law to the product of throughput and average response time. And all that we said is, there is actually a think time which should be added to the response time to calculate the total number in the system. In short, if you have a system which gives X throughput and whose response time requirement is R, which is being met with Z think time, then that system can sustain N concurrent users, is the conclusion that you can. I'll just give one example here to show how you can do simple validation of inputs. Consider program trading and automatic order processing, the requirement of a broker. Broker, you know what is program trading? The trading on internet you do by typing out the code and saying, I want to purchase 20 shares, sell 30 shares or something like that. This is what investors like you and I will do. What day traders do, day traders means people who sell and purchase during the same day without having either the money or the shares. But at the end of the day, they square up. That is the speculation which keeps the market as it is. Now, day trader also ordinarily types. But suppose he has written an algorithm. Okay. He has written an algorithm which automatically, based on some parameters, places a buy order, places a sell order, etc. He wants a response time of 100 milliseconds. He wants the processing throughput of 1,000 orders per second. And he says, I will have totally 10 concurrent users. So if I have 10 concurrent users with his throughput expectation of 1,000 orders per second and the response time of 100 milliseconds, forget the thinking time at all, whatever be the thinking time. The Little's law says n is equal to x into r plus z. In this particular case, if I put values, I do not know what the think point time is permitted. 10 is equal to 1,000 into 0.1 plus z. Since z is non-zero and people think in physical time only, not negative time. I can't say I have thought yesterday or something. I have to think now. Like, whatever be the value of z, this equation can never be satisfied. So if a broker makes such a request saying, build me such software, there is no point in spending time in system analysis, design, writing SQL queries, implementing it, and then wondering why the hell the system is not working. So you advise him, buy 3 more servers, 10 more servers, doesn't matter. Any number of servers, any kind of gigabit bandwidth, 10 gigabit, nothing will serve, because Little's law says, 10 is not equal to 100 plus 1000 Z. Z may be 0.1, Z may be 0.2, Z may be whatever. It is possible only if this R is different. So I have to tell the broker, in practical terms, what it means. It means that if you want 10 concurrent users and if you want to process 1000 orders per second, I cannot guarantee a 100 millisecond response time. There are many examples. The slide deck of Dr. Rajesh Mancharamani contains some additional examples as well. It is worthwhile for you to look at what all those things say. What we will right now do is just to conclude this by some practical aspects of performance evaluation, just as an introduction. How do you evaluate the performance? The Little's law is useful to you in doing a broad analysis. And as I said, you can apply these thumb rules right at the outset. So the example that I was giving you, where there was an RFP, and the RFP said that the throughput must be so many orders per se, or so many transactions per second, and total number of concurrent users are so many. They found out by the Little's law that it appeared that to assume some reasonable think time. They found out that the whole thing was becoming very unrealistic. If they had to give that kind of response time and throughput, the system was becoming extraordinarily large. And Dr. Rajesh Mancharamani, while helping the team in TCS preparing this tender, he said, this looks something very funny to me. So it doesn't matter, whatever you do, they will hit the bottleneck sooner or later if they change this parameter slightly. He did another calculation. What he found out is, if that is the throughput and given the think time, he knew the total number of requests that the department handles in a year. Okay, this was, let me not name the department, cases, let's say, total number of cases. There's so many million cases per year that the department handles. He proved, using the same law, calculating that given the response time requirement and given the throughput requirement, okay, the number of users and throughput requirement only. He said that the entire job of the department for 1 year will get completed in 7 working days. So the user had goofed up. The user had not put a realistic requirement. So they actually asked this question that, look, is that what you want? Do you want us to design a system which will complete all your department work in 7 days only? Then the answer was no, it will not. Then it was pointed out that it can be done, but it will take humongously large hardware. It's not required. The RFP was actually cancelled by that department, and a new RFP was floated, which actually saved very large amount. I mean, the system which came in was less than 1/4 the cost of what it would have been. Now that's a large cost, just by validating the user in. So the Little's law is truly is not of little significance, of a great significance. And you may try to use it in whichever way. At least as a thumb rule calculation about performance, you should always do that. The other problem that we have is, we have already some software. It's working. We have developed it. Now we want to see, how does this software perform? Does this give me so many transactions per second? Okay. The earlier that what we talked about is capacity planning, hardware and so on. But given my software, how does it perform on a given hardware? Or in order to make this software give me so many transactions per second, what hardware should I use? That is the capacity planning exercise. Should I have 4 processors, 8 processors, 20 processors, whatever one. For that, a typical methodology adopted is called benchmarking. A benchmarking exercise is, you actually have a benchmark in mind, so many transactions per second, throughput, so much response time, etc., etc. And you have your software, and you say, I want to run this software, show me whether your hardware will give me this performance, or give me a hardware which will give me this performance. So ideally what I should do is, I should go to a vendor saying, okay, give me some hardware, let me see what it does. It's not satisfactory, add more processors, add more memory, add more disk, whatever, and perform. But for that, I need to run this software in a simulated mode. In actual practice, let's say 1,000 concurrent users are going to use this software. I cannot make 1,000 people physically sit and run this. So I'll have to simulate. Simulating such end users, and in fact simulating even the functionality of my requirement, is one important attribute of this benchmark exercise. I want to simulate number of users. I want to identify the transaction types that will be executed. Then I will have to set up the software under test. Whatever application I will have, I have to configure that application. I have to configure one or more database servers, configure application servers, configure reporting servers. Or if I don't have a separate reporting server, I may want to configure the load of copying to an operational data store. This is one thing which is often important to remember. People run their benchmark. They will take your software and they will run the database. Let's say there are queries, and you will push a lot of transactions. It will show so many transactions. At that time, those servers are doing nothing but running SQL query. The moment somebody tries to run a report, the thing will sync. And that is because while measuring, you did not run the report. Even simple thing like spooling services for printer are switched off from the operating system when you run a benchmark. This is cheating. What you have to do is, you have to simulate the real life. So in real life, whatever services your operating system will run, database will run, whatever actual activities will run, all of that should be part of your load simulation. Then only you will get realistic value. Then you have to set up the load, and you have to decide the measurement parameters. Finally, you have to conduct multiple tests. In general, even when you have your software ready, it takes anywhere between 2 months to 6 months to actually conduct these tests. It's not easy to do that. And that is why most of the evaluations that we do in life do not have actual benchmark. Since that's the fact, the industry has come up with a cooperative venture called Transaction Processing Council. These benchmarks, by the way, is nothing new. The earliest benchmark was a debit credit benchmark. It's just banks debit and credit. Jim Gray was the one. Jim Gray is no more. He is considered one of the biggest gurus of databases. He was the creator of IBM System R, or DB2. He's known as the mother of DB2. He's no more. He died in a freak accident. He took a yacht in the Bay Area in the sea and simply disappeared, never came back. It was a very sad thing. He was a Turing Award winner, a great computer scientist of the last century. So he first introduced this debit credit benchmark. This was the first time he introduced the notion of think time. Says the clerk in the cashier always will measure cash, write something. It's not that as if he's just doing fatafat transactions. There was a transaction processing council which was set up as a cooperative venture, as I said. All major vendors of the world support this. And the TPC has a large number of user members as well. And this council then released the first versions of benchmarks called Transaction Processing Council's A benchmark and B benchmark. TPC A, TPCB were the first standard benchmarks. Subsequently, there's a TPCC and TPCD. TPCH is the current benchmark which is being used for data warehousing applications. We in LIC use this benchmark by modifying it to reflect our business considerations, and we have to map your performance requirements to the standard benchmark. This task is non-trivial. Even this takes 2 to 3 months. And then, ideally, if you can run your own application, that is best. If you can't, you map your application transactions into a standard and run these standards. The advantage of these standards is all hardware manufacturers from time to time continue to publish their benchmark results. And internally in the labs, they have benchmark results for different configurations of that model. So it's a very good thumb rule test by which you can go by. So this was the last thing I wanted to mention. Although this course has been packed with contents, I wanted to emphasize that this is just a glimpse of the cutting-edge technology that is available today. I hope you have now understood that while databases are extremely important and useful, they are not the only thing. They are just one of the n things that need to be deployed to build your applications. So first of all, databases itself, please read the textbook for more details and try to solve exercises. There is no shortcut of solving problem. Okay. And the problems could be difficult, so better try solving them jointly. Now this is an important suggestion. Form groups of 2 or 3 persons and execute group projects. As the as Mrs. Sukumar said the other day, we are planning a follow-up course. The course, incidentally, the dates are fixed in August because that's the only time we have the guest house rooms. So that gives you June and July as 2 months. In these 2 months, I would like your small groups to do projects. Take a subset problem from LIC's own domain. Now, schema definition, schema design, etc. A good point to start with, this was Seema's suggestion. The logical data model prepared for your data warehouse, okay, is a domain schema. From that domain schema itself, you can take that subset of schema for which you have the relevant data in terms of your FAP system and make group projects like that. Do in these projects some part of a proper analysis and design to the extent that we have discussed. If possible, refer to any standard software engineering methodology. Follow your own organizational methodology. And then design a schema, design some transactions, at least identify the reports and queries that you would like to do. This is a project we would like you to do in a coordinated fashion. The idea is that these projects should actually be formally submitted. Because if you have to just do and forget, then the tendency may be to forget it also. So you do these projects and you submit. I would expect one of your group to become a coordinator for the whole group. And this coordinator through email should set up these groups, should do these projects. We will not do a very heavy evaluation of those projects, except just to get a feedback of how well you have been able to use whatever knowledge you have got it. But if you do this, then the next course in August, which will be on the Java-based, DBA-based application development, will be much more meaningful to you. And towards that end, simultaneously, I will suggest, start reading something on object-oriented paradigm. There are enough books on this. You can start reading them only as a storybook. Of course, you have to continue to work in your development center for supporting your applications. I hope you have enjoyed this course. I wish you a very happy database programming, and thanks and goodbye.